I'm at the Bingham Gallery, and behind me is a stunning painting of Cirencester, the capital of the Cotswolds, and joining me now is the artist Laurie Plant. How were you involved in this project? How did it come about?
I came across the Bingham Library Trust and asked them if they'd be interested in commissioning a piece of work, and they, you know, took the project up, and it's been about 2 years in the making.
It's so intricate, and there's so much fine detail. Can you tell us what were the inspirations behind each sketch in the painting?
Find out more about the town and Daniel Bingham's life and legacy, and how that's had an impact on Cirencester.
Did you manage to fit everything about Cirencester, or did you miss things out? How did you choose?
I thought, what would Daniel Bingham think? What was his impact, or is his legacy, and how would he have thought about the way that other benefactors or other people have contributed towards the town? So that's really helped. But also, some things just excite you. Some things you just want to include. I spoke with one of the curators here, and she said, how would you include the industrial part of the town, Love Lane? And so, investigating that area, I thought, this is a family business, Alex Cars, that's been going on for years and years there. And you can show these buses quite simply through the generation, the ages, as a representation of more the industry, but also, you know, how these school buses are part of the education of the town. But then how do you include them in a way that is a bit more weird, exciting, unusual or strange? I've tried to do it here, you know, by including, superimposing Daniel Bingham's ear across the side of the Alex Cars bus.
The work in progress, how many drawings and sketches did you have to do before you came to the canvas?
Well, I've done about 35 chalk drawings and watercolours outside. I've also done a lot of, if you like, on the back of the envelope type sketches, ideas, notes and drawings that are quite a valuable way of revealing the attitude in terms of the stages of making this picture. And they're things that sort of really get lost. This clock here, I did about five little drawings of it, working on ideas about how I might melt it and make it a much more skewed shape, mm-hmm. in the way that the sign is,
yes.
sort of melting here. And those little drawings were stuck on the canvas. But, you know, they're kind of just, in a sense, throwaway. They get folded up. My favourite bit is the way that you've got a composite to make the whole picture come together, and the way that that's come together as a magical entity, so that I could never have... Although I had a general idea that it's 4 foot square and that there's a vortex in the middle and it's kind of kaleidoscopic and buildings move and twist and turn, it's the magic that when you're making this picture, at the end of the day, like, the words don't describe it, so you've just got to sort of stop and look. So the whole thing, I think, as a full piece of work is the favourite thing.
I thought you were going to say it's because Cotswold TV are in the car here, that's what I was after, don't worry.
Cotswold, it's interesting, including something like Cotswold TV, the car and the company represent a forward-thinking internet media, and Daniel Bingham built the library, gave the money to build the libraries, and he was quite progressive and he wanted people to come in and read and educate themselves and find out more about the media. And, you know, that's what's happening now with this little company.
And the vortex aspect of the painting, is that something that you do quite a lot of, or is this new to you?
The idea of a kind of vortex is a simple device, really, that enables you to create the idea that a lot of things are moving and tumbling around. And I did it in abstract paintings first. But when I used more realistic images or pictures, it actually looked a little more unusual.
You've fit in so many buildings, and they look like either one of them could be on top of the other. How did you decide which ones you were going to put down first?
I kind of know they're going to be a particular size, within the 4 foot square that I've got so that they'll cover a certain area. And I tend to start in the middle of, in the center of the vortex. But when they start to accrue and overlap and you get more of them, it's part of the magic of the picture making that it becomes quite mysterious, and something will work because, you know, of something like a particular colour or a particular meaning, but then something else upsets the balance. And you kind of get lost in the picture as you make it. How does it work in terms of just, you know, colour and tone and form and shape and pattern and perspective and depth and twisting and turning this mysterious puzzle together?
This building here, you can't just draw something that still looks like it's in perfect ratio. How did you get that building to look like that?
Well, I love architectures like Santiago Calatrava makes amazing buildings that move and twist and bend and component parts that come apart and change shape. And Zaha Hadid also tries to create buildings that you'd think about if you didn't have to worry about gravity, like you get in suprematist paintings. And because I love making buildings move, the sculptor David Nash says, you know, spheres turn and squares stand still, and the implied movement of a spire reaching. If you kind of don't have gravity, like you've got more of a vortex than a tumble, you can make things happen that wouldn't necessarily happen, especially with old or classical buildings. That's quite good fun. So up here, this block, and it is a real perspectival sort of block of Tontine buildings, I repainted them 4 times in the picture. I had a watercolour I'd done, and I actually twisted and bent the watercolour, so the sheet of paper became very sculptural. And then I made about 25 photographs of twisting it. And then I selected one that I thought showed the space being quite confusing. You get that kind of confusion going on, which is interesting to work with architectural structures like that. It's called anamorphosis, the stretching of an image like that. And Holbein, in his painting The Ambassadors in the National Gallery, famously did that with a skull. And it's a great way of including it in an exciting sort of representation, but also put in elements like this, which are quite modern in terms of their look and feel, uninflected colour, felt tip type dotted lines, mm-hmm. And scribbly sorts of shapes, next to a kind of very traditional fat over lean sort of way of putting together a portrait. And down this side of the picture you can see the face squash back into perspective and alignment. Can you see it?
Yes, absolutely. And it's interesting that when you first come in to look at it, you don't notice it. And you said someone thought it was a sunset and clouds. And now, it's so obvious that it's his face and you can't miss it now.
And there's great fun in filling a picture with surprises like that, where something's right under your nose, but you don't necessarily see it until you look in a different way or perceive it, you know, in an unexpected way. And that happens, I think, all over in the painting.